A warm welcome to all the students. Continuing with our discussion on the classification of animal kingdom, we are going to cover three phyla in this session: Mollusca, Echinodermata, and Hemichordata. So let's start with the first phylum of this session, Mollusca. The name of this phylum has been derived from a Latin word, mollus or mollusca, which means soft. The members of this phylum are soft body, hence the name Mollusca. This phylum has about 80,000 living and 35,000 extinct species known till date, which makes it the second largest phylum in the animal kingdom after the phylum Arthropoda. The study of mollusks and their shells, which is a unique characteristic of this phylum, is known as malacology or conchology. Now let's have a look at the body plan of the molluscans. The body can be roughly differentiated into four parts: head, foot, visceral mass, and mantle. Head may or may not be clearly demarcated in the members. It consists of sensory organs such as tentacles, eyes, statocysts, etc. The second part is foot, which is a muscular organ and is used for locomotion. Third part is the visceral mass, which contains various organs related to digestion, reproduction, and circulation. And the last part is mantle, which is a fold of the skin of the dorsal body wall. It secretes the shell if it is present and contains gills or lungs meant for respiration. This diagram shows a basic ancestor compiling the general characteristics of this phylum. We can see that the body is covered with a shell on the outermost side, and the fold of skin beneath the shell is the mantle. There is a foot on the mantle side, which is used for locomotion. The alimentary canal has two openings, the mouth and the anus, with specialized parts such as stomach. Heart can be seen, meant for circulation, and gills for respiration. Now let's have a look at the general characteristics of this phylum. The members of this phylum, known as mollusks, may be aquatic or terrestrial in habitat. They generally exhibit bilateral symmetry, except snails, which are asymmetrical. The body is unsegmented and enclosed within a fold of the skin, which is known as mantle or pallium. The mantle secretes one or two shells, which may be external or internal. They are triploblastic coelomate animals, but the true coelom is reduced and limited to kidney and gonads. The circulatory system is of open type, except in cephalopods. In open-type circulatory system, the blood leaves the network of the capillaries and enters the cavity between the tissues, known as hemocoel, from where the tissues exchange gases through diffusion. The respiration takes place with the help of gills or pulmonary chambers. The digestive system is well-developed and consists of regula and hepatopancreas. Radula is a characteristic rasping organ which is unique to mollusks and found in every class of this phylum. It is a minutely toothed chitinous ribbon which is used for scraping or cutting food before it enters the esophagus. And hepatopancreas is an organ in digestive tract which is analogous to the liver and pancreas found in higher animals. The excretion takes place by means of organ of Bezanus or Keber's organ. The organ of Bezanus is a molluscan kidney. It is the organ of excretion named after the scientist Bezanus, who discovered it or described it for the first time. And then we have the Keber's organ, which is also known as pericardial gland. It is a large reddish-brown glandular mass, which is situated anterolateral to the pericardium, into which it discharges the waste material. The nervous system is well developed. The sensory organs are eyes, statocysts, and osteridia. Eyes generally do not provide detailed vision. They rather act as directional light sensors. The statocysts, they are vesicles containing statolith, which is a stone-like structure made up of calcium carbonate. It is located near the pedal ganglia and acts as the balancing organ. Osteridia is a chemosensory structure which is found in the mantle cavity and is used for testing the chemical nature of the water which enters it. The sexes can be separated or united. Development is either direct or indirect. In case of indirect development, it involves veliger and trochophore larvae. On the basis of shell and foot, this phylum Mollusca has been further classified into the classes Aplacophora, Monoplacophora, Polyplacophora, Gastropoda, Scaphopoda, Pericypoda, and Cephalopoda. Let's start with the class Aplacophora. Plac means plate and for means carrying. So this class constitutes of those animals which do not carry or wear a plate. The head, mantle, foot, shell, and nephridia are absent in the members of this class. The body is covered with a cuticle. The digestive tract is straight and consists of the characteristic rasping organ radula. A mid-dorsal longitudinal keel or crest is present. The example of this class is Chaetoderma. The next class is the class Monoplacophora, that means one plate carrying animals. The shell of the members of this class is composed of a single valve or plate. Actually, the shell is made up of one or more articulating parts in the mollusk, and each part is known as a valve. Their head is without eyes and tentacles. Tentacles are also sensory organs. The example of this class is Neophelina galathea. It is a living fossil and connecting link between annelida and mollusca. Neophelina is the only living member of this class. It lived during the Cambrian period, and it is considered a connecting link between annelida and mollusca because its body shows true segmentation or metamerism, which is a characteristic feature of annelida. The body is segmented and has repeated nephridial units. Also, the body is covered with a shell, which is a unique feature of phylum Mollusca. Therefore, it is considered a connecting link between annelida and mollusca. The next class is class Polyplacophora, that is many plate bearing. The shell, as the name indicates, is composed of a longitudinal series of 8 shell plates. The foot is flat and ventral. In position, radula is well developed. The example of this class is chitin. This is the dorsal view of the chitin. It is a primitive marine shell and is small to large in size. It is also commonly known as sea cradle or coat of mail shell. As we can see, the dorsal shell is composed of 8 separate valves or plates, which are surrounded by a girdle, often consisting of spicules, bristles, hairy tufts, scales, etc. The majority of body is foot. The chitin creeps along slowly on the muscular foot, which has considerable power of adhesion, so it clings very strongly to the rocks. No other head or soft parts are visible from the dorsal side. Chitons even exhibit homing behavior. They return to the same spot for daylight hours and roam around at night to feed. The next class of phylum Mollusca is Gastropoda. It is the largest and most well-known class of this phylum. Gaster means stomach and podus means foot. Since the members of this class appear to move on their stomach, hence the class has been named Gastropoda. They exhibit asymmetry. The shell is composed of a single valve and is spirally coiled. The head is distinct and consists of sensory tentacles, eyes, and a mouth. The foot is ventral in position and muscular. The buccal cavity is provided with the characteristic radula. The circulatory system is open in nature, in which blood leaves the network of capillaries and enters the hemocoel, from where the tissues surrounding the hemocoel exchange gases through diffusion. The sexes are mostly separate, and the development is indirect and includes veliger and trochophore larval stages. The examples of this class are Heliotis, Cypria, which is commonly known as Cori, Phyla, the apple snail, Murex, known as the rock shell, Aplysia, commonly called sea hare, and Doris, which is also commonly known as sea lemon. The next class of this phylum is Scaphopoda, meaning shovel-footed. Since the adults of this class remain buried inside the sand or mud with the help of their foot, hence the name Scaphopoda. The members of this class have a tubular shell which is open at both ends, whereas most of the mollusks have a shell which has a single opening. The foot is boat-shaped, and the most common example of this class is Dentalium, which is also known as tusk shell due to its appearance. This is the Dentalium, commonly known as tusk shell due to its elephant tusk-like appearance. The shell is tubular and is open at both the ends. In most of the other models, the shell is open at one end, but this is the characteristic feature of this class, that the shell is open at both the ends. They live their adult lives buried in sand or mud with head pointed downwards. The head lacks eyes and is used for burrowing. The only narrow posterior end of the shell sticks up in the seawater for exchange of water and waste expulsion. The gills have been lost, so the mantle not only produces shell but also obtains oxygen from the seawater. So the mantle tissue performs two functions. Mantle is fused into a tube that surrounds the body of the animal but is open at both the ends. Water circulates around the mantle cavity by action of numerous cilia. When the dissolved oxygen runs low, the water is ejected through the top end of the shell by contraction of the foot. The next class of phylum Mollusca is Pelecypoda. Since the shell of the members of this class is composed of two distinct shell plates or walls, therefore this class is also known as Bivalvia. The animals of this class are bilaterally symmetrical and laterally compressed. They do not have a distinct head. The sexes may be separate or united. The development is indirect and takes place through a glaucidium larva. The examples of this class are Mytilus, Unio, and Crito. Pearl oyster belongs to this class. The next class of phylum Mollusca is Cephalopoda. Cephalus means head and podus means foot. Since the foot of the members of this class of animals seems to be directly attached to their head, hence the name Cephalopoda. The foot is modified into arms and siphon. Arms are specialized for grasping the prey, whereas siphon assists in locomotion. The water is drawn into the mantle cavity and is expelled through the siphon, creating a jet propulsion, which shoots the animal in the opposite direction. The shell may be absent or rudimentary if present. In case of having the shell, it may be internal or external. Odontophore with a radula is present. Odontophore is the cartilaginous base of radula and is movable, and its movement helps in erecting the teeth of radula. The ink glands, which create ink clouds, are present for offense and defense. The sexes are separate, and the development is direct without any larval stage. The example of this class are Nautilus, Loligo, Sepia, and Octopus. This is the dorsal view of a squid or Loligo in the swimming position. It has a long tapering body covered with a tube-shaped mantle, which protects the internal organs. The head protrudes from the mantle. Water is drawn into the mantle and oral gills. The muscles then contract and send water through narrow muscular funnels. The eyes are large and complex, which provides it with a very sharp vision. Arms have suckers over their entire length. The position of fins may vary in different species. The next phylum that we are going to discuss is phylum Echinodermata. The name of this phylum has been derived by the combination of two Greek words. First is echinos, which means spiny, and the second means dermatos, that is skin. The members of this phylum have rough spiny skin, hence the name Echinodermata. The animals of this phylum exhibit organ system level of body organization, and around 6,000 living species of this phylum are known till date. Let's have a look at the general characteristics of this phylum. The animals are exclusively marine in habitat, found only in sea and not in fresh water. They are free living in nature. They are triploblastic and have three distinct germ layers, ectoderm, endoderm, and mesoderm, giving rise to various tissues and organs in the body. They consist of a true coelom, that is a true body cavity lined by mesoderm. They belong to the deuterostome's line of evolution. During the embryonic stage of development, the first opening, that is the blastopore, develops into the anus, and the second opening develops into the mouth. They exhibit pentamerous radial symmetry in adults, but radial symmetry is of secondary nature because their larva has the basic bilateral symmetry, and when it develops into the adult, it acquires radial symmetry. As the name itself indicates, they have a tough, leathery, and spiny skin. Their endoskeleton, which is derived from the mesoderm, is made up of calcareous plates known as ossicles. They have a characteristic water vascular system, also known as ambulacral system, which is composed of various canals in the body, which are connected to the tube feet. Echinoderms move by alternately contracting their muscles, which forces the water into the tube feet and then relaxing them. Other than locomotion, tube feet also assist in feeding and respiration. The circulatory system is of the open type. Sensory organs are poorly developed. There are no specialized organs for excretion. Pedicellariae are present on the body surface. These are pincer-like structures present on the body surface in between the spine, and they help in cleaning off the debris and algae on the surface. Their development is indirect and takes place through a bilaterally symmetrical larval stage. Respiration takes place with the help of dermal branchiae or papulae in starfish, peristomial gills in sea urchins, genital bursae in brittle stars, and cloacal respiratory tree in holothuriums. They exhibit excellent power of regeneration. There are two figures on the slide. The first one shows the water vascular system of a starfish. The water enters the system through a sieve-like structure on the upper surface of animal, which is known as madreporite. Now, this madreporite overlies a small sac or ampulla, which is connected to a duct known as stone canal, which is commonly lined with calcareous material. The stone canal runs to a circular ring canal, from which radial canals run outward along the ambulacral grooves. Each arm of a starfish has one such groove on its underside. Now, each side of a radial canal gives rise to a row of bulb-like ampullae. These ampullae are connected to sucker-like podia. The entire structure is known as a tube feet. The contraction of ampullae causes podia to stretch as water is brought into them. This whole process allows for the movement and is quite powerful but extremely slow. Although the contents of the water vascular system are essentially seawater, the fluid also contains coelomocytes, some protein, and high level of potassium salt. The second figure shows the pedicellariae and spine on the skin of an echinoderm. Pedicellariae are small wrench or claw-shaped structure. Each is composed of forceps-like balls. They keep the body surface clean of algae, encrusting organisms, and other debris in conjugation with the ciliated epidermis. This diagram shows the general anatomy of a typical echinoderm, starfish in this case. The body is radially symmetrical, pentamerous, and contains a system of water-filled canals known as water vascular system or ambulacral system, which we have already discussed. It connects with the tube feet or podia, which generally protrude through holes in the skeleton. Areas with such holes are known as ambulacra. The tube feet often have suction cups on their tips and are used for locomotion. They also function in feeding, respiration, and sensory reception. An ambulacral groove on the oral or underside extends from the mouth to the end of each arm. Opposite the ambulacral groove is an ambulacral ridge on the aporal side of each ray. Gonads fill the whole arms. When filled with sperms or eggs during the spawning season, digestive gland secretes digestive juices which assist in the digestion of food. The rectal cecum, which can be seen here as a lobed structure, is a cul-de-sac which surrounds the intestine and obscures its junction with the body wall. The stomach has two parts, the cardiac part and the pyloric part. Cardiac portion pumps the blood, whereas the pyloric portion connects to the duodenum and assists in the digestion of food. The phylum Echinodermata has been further classified into the classes Asteroidea, Ophiuroidea, Echinoidea, and Holothuroidea. So let's start with the class Asteroidea and have a look at the general characteristics. The members of this class are commonly known as starfishes or sea stars because of their star-like appearance. They have five arms, and the arms are not sharply differentiated from the central disc. The tube feet consists of suckers which are orally placed in ambulacral grooves. The anus and madreporite are aboral in position. Pedicellariae are present for cleaning of the surface. And they are slow creeping, predaceous and scavengerous in nature. The examples of this class are Astropactin, Oreaster, also known as Pantaceros, and Asterias. The next class is Ophiuroidea. The members of this class are commonly known as brittle stars. Their body is also star-like, but their arms are sharply demarcated off from the central disc. They lack pedicellariae on their body surface. The stomach is sac-like and without anus. Ambulacral grooves are either absent or covered by calcareous plates known as ossicles. Their tube feet also lack suckers. Madreporite is oral in position. The examples of this class are Ophiura, Ophiothrix, and Ophioderma. This figure shows the oral view of brittle star's central disc, and these five are the ends of the arms which are attached to the central disc. As can be seen in the diagram, the central disc is sharply marked off from the arms. Mouth is present on the oral side, surrounded by five toothed jaws. Madreporite is usually located within one of the jaw plates. The vessels of water vascular system and in podia or tube feet. They are generally scavengers in nature. The tube feet move the food into the mouth. The gas exchange and excretion occurs through the cilia lined sac known as bursae, which each opens between the arm bases on the underside through openings known as bursal slits. The water flows through bursae by means of cilia or muscular contraction. Oxygen is transported through body via hemal system. Phagocytic coelomocytes collect waste products in body cavity and migrate through these bursal slits for expulsion from the body. The next class is Echinoidea. The members of this class have globular body as in sea urchins or flattened disc-like body as in sea cakes. The mouth is present at the lower end and is covered by Aristotle's lantern. Aristotle's lantern is a biting and chewing apparatus which is formed by five strong sharp teeth. The tube feet are with suckers. The skin ossicles fuse together into a rigid globular disc-like or heart-shaped shell or test with movable spines. Pedicellariae are present on the body surface. Anus is present and the development is indirect, which passes through larval forms called Pluteus and Echinopluteus. The examples of this class are sea urchins and sand dollars. This figure shows the oral view of Atlantic sea urchin. Sea urchins are symmetrical and globular in body shape. Their test is round and spiny. Urchin is the old name for hedgehogs. Since due to their spiny skin they resemble the hedgehogs, they have been named as sea urchins. The spines present on the body surface are movable and consist of venomous pedicellariae in between them. The lower half of the body is known as oral surface because it contains the mouth, and the upper half is known as the aboral surface. Mouth is surrounded by lips of softer tissues with bony pieces embedded in them. This area is known as peristome and is covered by a peristomial membrane. Five pairs of short, thick tube feet or buccal podia surround the mouth. In the middle we can see tooth of lantern. It is a part of Aristotle's lantern, which is a chewing and biting apparatus meant for feeding, and is composed of five strong teeth. Gills are meant for respiration. The next class is class Holothuroidea. The members of this class have a long and cylindrical body which is elongated in oral and aboral axis and lacks arms. The mouth is at the anterior end of the body and anus is present at the posterior end. Mouth is surrounded by denticles. Tube feet are usually present and are sucker-like. The skin is leathery but lacks any kind of spines or pedicellariae. Respiration and excretion takes place by respiratory tree in cloaca just inside the anus. What is drawn inside the anus? The respiratory tree has a series of thin tubules. Gas exchange and excretion of waste products takes place through the thin walls of the tubules into the water, and then the water is expelled out from the anus. Development is indirect through the larval form known as auricularia. The examples of this class are Holothuria and Cucumeria. This figure shows the external morphology of Cucumeria frondosa, one of the species of the sea cucumbers. As you can see, the body is elongated and lacks arms. The skin is leathery. The body wall is made up of catch collagen, which can be tightened or loosened at will. The anterior end contains mouth and a circlet of oral tentacles, while the posterior end contains the anus. Most sea cucumbers have five stripe-like ambulacral areas running along the length of the body from the mouth to the anus. Three on the lower surface have numerous tube feet, often with suckers, that allow the animal to crawl along. The two on the upper surface have underdeveloped or vestigial tube feet or podia. They possess an internal skeleton composed of calcareous plates. In most sea cucumber species, they become reduced to microscopic ossicles embedded beneath the skin. They are typically dioecious. The reproductive system consists of a single gonad consisting of cluster of tubules emptying into a single duct, the gonoduct, that opens at the upper surface of the animal, close to the tentacles. The next class of phylum Echinodermata is Crinoidea. They have a pentamerous body which can be distinguished into a central disc and five or more arms radiating from the disc. The disc is enclosed in a calyx of calcareous plates. Calyx is attached to the substratum with a stalk or a subaural surface. The mouth and anus are both present on the oral surface. Two feet are sucker-like and restricted to central disc only and not on the arms. Some forms, such as sea lilies, are permanently sessile, while others, such as feather stars, are free-swimming forms. Pedicellaria are absent on the skin. The examples of this class, as we have already mentioned, are sea lilies and feather stars, whose zoological name is Antidon. This is the diagram of a feather star. As we can see, the body can be distinguished into three basic sections: the stem, the calyx, and the arms. The stem is composed of highly porous ossicles connected by ligamentary tissues. Calyx contains digestive and reproductive organs. Mouth is at the top of dorsal cup, surrounded by feeding arms. This animal has a U-shaped gut, therefore the anus is located next to the mouth, close to the periphery. The arms display pentaradial symmetry and comprise smaller ossicles than stem, and are equipped with cirri, which facilitate feeding by moving the organic material down the arm into the mouth. Majority of the animals are free swimming and have only a vestigial stalk. Base of the stalk consists of a disc-like sucker, which in some species has root-like structures that further increase its grip on underlying surface. Stalk is often lined with small cirri. The next phylum that we are going to discuss is phylum Hemichordata, the last phylum of this session. The word Hemichordata has been derived by the combination of two Greek words. First is hemi, that means half, and second is chordae, which means cord. It was earlier considered as a subphylum of Chordata, but now it is undoubtedly placed as a phylum under non-chordates. Now let's have a look at the general characteristics of this phylum. The body of the members of this phylum can be divided into proboscis, collar, and trunk. The notochord or the buccal diverticulum or the stomochord, whose presence has given this phylum its name, is a hollow outgrowth from the roof of the buccal cavity and is confined to the proboscis and non-homologous with that present in the chordates. Therefore, it has now been placed under non-chordates. The gill slits are dorsal in position, whereas the nerve cord is ventral. Respiration takes place by means of gills. Circulatory system is open type, in which the blood flows out of the capillary network into the sinuses, from where the surrounding tissues exchange gases through diffusion. The development is mostly indirect through a free-swimming larval stage, which is known as Tornaria larva. The members of this phylum are known as acorn worm due to their acorn-like or oak nut-like proboscis. Balanoglossus is the largest species. As you can see, the body can be differentiated into three parts: the acorn-shaped proboscis, a short fleshy collar, and long worm-like trunk. Mouth is present on the collar behind the proboscis and anus at the posterior end of the trunk. Gill slits ventral in position can be seen on the body. Body is covered with cilia and glands that secrete mucus. Some of the species also secrete a bromide compound which gives them a medicinal smell and might help them in protection against predators and bacteria. If we look at the Tornaria larva of the hemichordates, we can see that it's pretty similar to the bipinnaria larva of echinoderms, except a few developmental gene differences. Phylum Hemichordata has been further classified into two classes. First is Anteropneusta and the second is Pterobranchia. So let's have a look at the general characteristics of the members of class Anteropneusta. This class has derived its name from the combination of two Greek words. First is anteron, that means gut, and second means neustos, that means breathing, since the members of this class have pharyngeal gill pores. They are commonly known as acorn or tongue worms, as you just saw in the diagram. This class has around 70 species. The body is large and has a worm-like trunk. The gill slits are numerous. Intestine is straight. The example of this class are Balanoglossus, which is the largest species, and the Stercoglossus. The next class is Pterobranchia, which has derived its name from the combination of two Greek words, pteron, that means feather, and branchion means gills, that is those with feathery gills. The members of this class are commonly called pterobranchs. This class has around 20 species. Body is small and compact. Gill slits are single pair or absent altogether. The intestine is U-shaped and not straight. The example of this class are Cephalodiscus and Rhabdopleura.